morning. Welcome to worship. We're glad to share this time with you. I love scripture that reminds us that the psalmist said, I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. We're glad you're here. We hope you are too. We have a lot of announcements in the bulletin I hope you will take notice of. In particular, we do have a Park Lake on Wednesday this week, and Pam Coburn is going to be talking to us about opera, and there's a little something on the back. I think it's going to be a lot of fun as well as informative, and the information is there for you. In addition, a couple of changes. Instead of Patty Denniston, Aaron Cook is going to be leading children's church today. And also the psalm scripture reading is not unison. It will just be read by our liturgist, Dan Deppelvoys. If you are visiting with us for the first time, we're very glad to have you here. We have a red pad that is on the inside aisle of your pew. If you are sitting next to it, would you be the one to pick it up and pass it down, sign it, kind of note to us if you are worshiping with us for the first time. We would like to be able to greet you speak to Dan or myself following worship. If you are interested in knowing more about the ministry of Christ in this place, we'd love for you to be a member. Let's begin our worship with the choral introit. And following the choral introit, a time of silence.
Christ has come bringing peace, joy to every heart. we are called to worship. The foolish say there is no God. We come trusting in Jesus, the face, the voice, the presence of God who loves us. The scoffers of our age ask, why do you seek after God? We come in this time because God's grace has spilled over in our lives. The hopeless around us think, no one cares about me. We come in this time to this place because Jesus has found us and brought us home. Let us pray. O Lord God, this is the day that you have made. Receive our glad songs, Lord. Fill our hearts with the wonder of your joy. Renew us in your grace and love. Pour out your Spirit upon us as we have come today to meet you in this time of worship. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Psalm 14. Fools say in their hearts, there is no God. They are corrupt. They do abominable deeds. There is no one who does good. The Lord looks down from heaven on humankind to see if there are any who are wise, who seek after God. They have all gone astray. They are all alike perverse. There is no one who does good. No, not one. Have they no knowledge, all the evildoers who eat up my people as they eat bread and do not call upon the Lord? There they shall be in great terror, for God is with the company of the righteous. You would confound the plans of the poor, but the Lord is their refuge. Oh, that deliverance for Israel would come from Zion, when the Lord restores the fortune of his people. Jacob will rejoice. Israel will be glad. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Which of us has hurt someone this week, intentionally or not? Which of us has spoken or thought ill of a sister or brother in Christ? Which of us has failed to do good when given the chance? All of us and each of us. But Christ came to redeem people just like us, so I invite you to join me as we offer our prayers to God. Holy God, we have believed we are experts at faithfulness, but we must confess those moments when we fail to do good for others. There are times we turn a deaf ear to the cries of people we have judged to be fools. There are times we have scoffed at those we believe have nothing to teach us or share with us. How foolish we are. Forgive us and bring us back under your guidance. Then send us out to search for all who sit in the shadowed corners of our world, yearning for someone to come and find them, even as Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, came to find us. Actions sometimes reveal we do not know God. Our words and lives show we do not understand God's hopes for us. But with utmost patience, God sets aside our foolishness and fills us with mercy. Mingled with faith and love, grace is poured into our thirsty souls, giving us new life, restoring us as God's children. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
peace of Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
I invite you to turn now and share Christ's peace with one another. Time now with children. If they'd like to come forward and sit on the steps and meet with me for a few minutes, I invite you to do so. Hey, Thomas, come on up. Come on, guys. Oh, here come our friends. So, remind me of y'all's names. Grayson and... Finley. Okay. You guys have been here before, but it's good to see you all again. Well, you know, I thought it'd be fun to have a party today. I like having parties. So I went. Where do you go if you're going to have a party? You go to the party store, don't you? Yeah. You have a party? So here's some things I got for us to have parties. Always good to have beads when you have a party. I think there's maybe enough beads. Take some beads and pass them out there, and everybody see if you... Anybody that... Once beads confess, this is like Mardi Gras, Thomas. There you go. There's some more there. Sorry, my aim's not very good. Hey, look, just enough for everybody. And also, when you're having parties, I think it's fun to have, y'all like these at your parties? Little thingy-ma-jigs. Yeah, here's one. Everybody can take one. No, you take the color you get, and then you can switch them around. They're all good colors. Just grab one. Well, just take one. I'll get you one, James. Here you go. Sorry, guys. Sorry. Come down here. I hope they work. That was a little... There you go. Yeah, they work. Yeah. Everybody else? Oops, sorry. Good job. Let's see, man. Anyone? Yeah, they work. There's three left. If anybody else wants to be part of the party, pass them out. Okay, everybody. Now, also, when we have parties, there's always fun to have a party song, a happy party song that you're singing at the parties. And let me sing this one. You all know it. If you want to join in a little bit later, Mr. Will and the choir are going to help us. But holly, holly, hallelujah. Holly, holly, hallelujah. Holly, holly, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Very good, very good. Party song. Very good. This is gonna good party. Okay, quiet. Now wait. No, hold on. No blowing for a second. If we're gonna have a party, we have to have a reason for a party, right? And I think it's fun to have a party sometimes when you find things that have been lost. In fact, Jesus talked about having parties when you find some things that have been lost. So I need two volunteers, Knox and James. Knox and James, would you volunteer? Because I need you guys to come together. All right, now Knox and James, listen. There is in this sanctuary a lost sheep. There's a lost sheep sitting somewhere. Would you go find that lost sheep so you can find that lost sheep and bring it here? Go ahead, Knox, go with James over there. You're not gonna go? Maybe James can handle it. Wait, James. Hold on, James. James, back here. Look over here, see if there's a lost sheep over there anywhere, right over there. James, see if you can find a lost sheep over here. Look around, there you go. Well, oh, you found it. James, bring the lost sheep, will you? There you go. Okay, come on, James. Good job. All right, now we can have a party. Come on, James. We can have a party because we found the lost sheep. All right, everybody, let's have a party. Let's celebrate. Holly. Quiet, there's also, I know, somewhere in this sanctuary, another story that Jesus talked about, and it's familiar, we might find it here, there is a coin that is lost. Jonathan, you know where the lost coin is? See if you can go find it. Is it lost? Yeah. You ready to start? Because we're going to have to give you a little cold warmer action, all right? So you can, anybody can go look for the coin. Cold, 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 cold. Cold, 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 cold. Warmer, 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 warmer. Cold, 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 cold. Warm, warm, hot, almost hot, almost hot. Almost hot up there. Hot, 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 hot. There's a lost coin. Look under the piano, 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 piano. Cold, cold, cold. Did you find it? All right, bring it back over. Good job. Good look at that coin. Let's have a party. Listen, one more. Now listen, Jesus also said there was a man who had two sons, and one of the sons was lost. Knox, listen, one of the sons was lost. I think there might be a lost man's son out here somewhere. Go look for him. See if you can find him. Oh, this is going to be too easy to find. See if you can find somebody that looks lost out here. Maybe that lost one could stand up a little bit. If you find him, bring him up here. You're walking right past him. Bring him on up. Bring him on up. Bring him on up. Bring him on up. Bring him up. Bring that lost son up here so we can have a party. Okay? Come on. Come on. Everybody, bring that lost son back on up here. Bring him on up. Back up, everybody. Come on. Come on. Good job. All right. All right. Now, this time, our party is going to be really good. So we're just singing this time, all right? No blowing. Just going to sing. And like before, they did such a wonderful job before, the organ and the choir. Listen, they're going to help us sing again for this lost son. One, two, three. Holly, holly. Wait, yeah, hold on, hold on. What's up with the choir and the organ? They're not singing, they're not playing at all. That kind of ruins the party, doesn't it? They were a big part of it, yeah. Well, you know, Jesus said, when that lost son came home and his father found him, he had a big party. His older brother refused to go in. He stood outside, grumpy, just like the choir and the organist today, all right? It was no fun at all. God wants us to celebrate and be joyful every time somebody special, wonderful, just like Mr. Walker, joins us up front and is a big part of our life together. No longer lost, take your sign off. A beloved child of God. All right, all together now, one last time. Alle, alle, alleluia. Alle, alle, alleluia. Alle, alleluia. 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 All right, let's pray together, all right? Dear God, thank you for helping us to be joyful and celebrate. Help us to remember everybody who is lost and then is found and give you thanks. Amen. Now, please put your squawkers in the bag before you go back down to children's time. Okay. Here, come on. get them later.
We are reading this morning from Luke 15. It is the story of the lost and the found. Listen for God's word. Now all the tax collectors and the sinners were coming near to listen to Jesus. And the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." Picking up in verse 11. And then Jesus said, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of the property that will belong to me.' So the father divided his property between the two sons. A few days later, the younger son gathered all that he had and traveled to a distant country, and there he squandered his property in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and he hired himself out to be one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. The young man would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare? But here I am dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he went off, and he went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. And he ran and put his arms around his son and kissed him. And then the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out a robe, do the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And get the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate. Now, his elder son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on, and the slave replied, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has got him back safe and sound.' But the brother became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him, but he answered his father, 'Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed your command. Yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came back, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fatted calf for him.' Then the father said to him, 'Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice because this brother of yours was dead and has come back to life. He was lost and has been found.' The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. You are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Luke 15, verses 11 through 32, is the story of two brothers, sons of a certain father. It is the story of lost and found. It is the story among stories of lost and found. It is the story of greed and grief and grace, of struggle to be faithful, and the extreme lengths to which faithful love will go. I am a middle child. I am deeply middle. I am the middle of the middle. I am the third of four siblings, the middle of three girls. I have all middle child angst and strengths. Fears of being left out, fears of not being noticed, but also being counted on, being the family peacekeeper. To this day, if there are issues the family is struggling with, I am often the one who is called to ferret it out and to be the stabilizing presence. Middle child. Psychologist Alfred Adler in the early 20th century formulated a theory about birth order on children. Oldest child. The eldest child in the family goes from being an only child to the oldest child, and that requires the child to learn how to share after perhaps years of not having to. Expectations on the oldest child are usually very high, which includes the need for that child to set an example to their siblings. This causes the child to trend towards authoritarianism and strict approaches towards others and in their own lives. They feel powerful and often require encouragement to be helpful. Are you an oldest child? Youngest children. The youngest child in the family often sees every sibling as a potential mother or father. Just about everyone tells them what to do and when to do it. Their role is never removed, though they might fight against it. This causes the child to want to grow up more quickly and make big plans, that many of which never come true. Many stay the baby, and many are frequently spoiled. The youngest child is often the entertainer, the daredevil. Are you a youngest child? Such is this parable. The faithfulness of the elder and the joie de vivre of the younger. The audience is a group of Pharisees and scribes who are watching Jesus socialize with tax collectors and with sinners. And the Pharisees hoarsely whisper so as to be heard. So Jesus throws out a parable. That's what parable means. It's something thrown out there. And so whoever gets it, gets it. Note that this story is tagged along with two other stories, as Dan was sharing with the children. A shepherd goes out to search for his sheep. A woman searches for a lost coin. These two parables don't do anything out of the ordinary beyond which anyone in their place would do. Go out and search for the lost. But the actions in this third story, the actions of the father, are unique and marvelous and divine. Which Ken Bailey says, was not done by any father in the past. Ken Bailey was a Presbyterian minister and taught for 40 years in the Middle East about understanding the New Testament from the Middle Eastern perspective. So when we read those stories, we understand the implications of that day. So Dr. Bailey writes that the demands and the actions of the youngest son would have shocked the original hearer. Jesus eases into the stories of the lost and found with the sheep, with this coin. But the shock of the story to the Middle Eastern culture is how this first, the younger son, shows extreme disrespect for his father. The youngest wants to go out and do it his own way and seek his own life. He asks for full right to, and full right to his inheritance while the father is in good health. In other words, he declares that his father is already dead to him and he wants what is coming to him. Bailey says this is extraordinary, that it is unparalleled in the Middle Eastern literature from ancient times until now. And the younger son leaves and the whole family is dead to him. And you heard the story. He played fast and free with his life and his money, his family's money. And he loses everything in a foreign land. And then he comes dragging back home, beat up and starved and with a plan, willing to be anything that the father wants him to be, just so he can have food. The lowest rank in his father's house has been better than anything that the world has offered him. I have observed those who leave the church in my 30 years of ministry. In brave moments, I've even gone out and had conversations with people about what they're doing and how they might be interacting with the church outside of the context of the church or with their faith, whether they still think about God at all. I have wondered aloud, and I've read books about declining numbers in houses of worship and the growing secularization of society. The United States is still one of the largest church-going countries, but not by much. Korea, Africa, people tend to flock to the church. Europe, hardly at all. Churches are museums. So we wonder, are people just not believers? Is faith irrelevant? We wonder, what is happening out there? There are others that are thinking about this. One of those is James K.A. Smith, Jamie Smith, who explains a book by Canadian social psychologist Charles Taylor. Charles Taylor, Dan referred to this last week, wrote this tome of 900 pages of dense writing, but answering this question about a secular age. And what does it mean to live in a secular age? James Smith condenses some of Taylor's thoughts when he says about secularism. He says, don't think of secularism as not as equivalent to unbelief. Secularity is a feature of contestability of belief. It is okay now to contest faith and its truth. That's one marker of a secular age. Second, Smith highlights that Taylor is talking about the emergence of the imminent frame, meaning I can figure it out right here what life is about. Where it used to be a transcendence, there is something in the meaning of life beyond me. But in the secular age, there is more the rising of figuring it out for self. So there's that tension. Third, the secular age is marked by a haunting. Smith notes that for both believers and non-believers, that haunting is seen through doubt and the possibility of faith. If cross-pressured means that a believer is tempted to doubt, then everybody is cross-pressured. And so the doubter is tempted to believe. And fourthly, Smith refers to Taylor's Nova effect as a result of a multiplicity of ways that people believe. Julian Barnes is a British author, and he's considered by many to represent this secular movement. And he writes in one of his books, Nothing to be Frightened of. Julian Barnes writes this, I don't believe in God, but I miss him. I don't believe in God, but I miss him. Smith says, that to me is the most succinct encapsulation of a messy complexity of what the secular age is. I don't believe in God, but I miss him. So there's a complexity here. The actions of a younger son, the youngest brother, demonstrates that he's wishing for his father's death. He wants to make it on his own. He's got a framework of what he wants. And so he asks for all that is coming to him and leaves his home for dead and goes out into the world. But when all is lost, he longs for home. There's a father who is waiting there, who shows unimaginable love. And there's an older son holding down the fort. Now the older brother. This older brother, as much as we might rush to defend him, Dr. Bailey says that he is following a similar path of the younger. The older brother, he's outside the house. He's coming in from the field. He gets as far as the front gate, and he hears music, and he freezes. He freezes to the sound that he fears. His father comes to the door for the older son. And he comes to the door to greet him, but no, he comes to the door to plead with him because he knows. He knows this faithful one is pretty upset. Bailey points out that the father's speech is neither an apology for the banquet nor a reproach directed against the older brother, but it is primarily a cry from the heart for an understanding of grace. Don't you see that we must celebrate? Very gently, the father reminds the older brother that this is your brother. It's not an attack. The visible and verbal appeal of love offers the only hope to the father, who doesn't want servants. He wants sons. And he wants the sons to be brothers. The younger brother was dead and is alive. The older brother is likewise dead. Can he come to life? What was it that was the brother's complaint? Was it that there was no fatted calf for him? Was it that he had been working years like a slave? The years of obedience without a reward? That he didn't have even as much as a young goat to celebrate with his friends? The oldest son says in response to the father's pleads to come into the house to join the party, "Listen, I've done everything you commanded me." I read that and I couldn't help to think about the study of commandments that we're beginning. You may know by now that we started a study of the Ten Commandments, or the Ten Words. Our women's circles are studying these at their monthly meetings throughout the year until May. The Fellowship Sunday School class starts a weekly 10-week study at the end of this month. And on the first Sunday of every month, Dan and I, from September through May, will be preaching on a commandment. So I heard this when the brother says, "I've done everything you commanded me." My ears perked up. Our study of the commandments, where is that going to take us? Is it going to take us in trying to understand how to be faithful? What it means to be people who are people of this promise, of these commandments. You might remember that story in Luke 18. It's only going to be three chapters beyond this one. When a certain ruler, in Matthew, this story is told, a rich young ruler. A certain ruler comes to Jesus and asks this question, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus says, "You know the commandments. You know what's commanded." The man says, "I've done them all. I've done them all." And Jesus says to him, "One more thing. Go and sell everything that you have, give it to the poor, and come follow me." One more thing, says Jesus, love your neighbor as yourself. And the man, as you might recall, went away sad because he had a lot. Back to our parable, I want you to remember again the audience that we have. It's certainly right not to make a one-on-one identification between the Pharisees and the older son, or the sinners and the younger son. Instead, what Jesus is doing, says Bailey, is describing two types of men. One is lawless without the law, and the other is lawless within the law. It was the responsibility of the older son to re-engage his younger brother with the father. And he's totally neglecting that, abdicating it, his role. Both of them rebel, both break the father's heart, both end up in a far country, one physically, one spiritually. The same unexpected love is demonstrated in humiliation to each. For both, this love is crucial if servants are to become sons. The father says to the older brother, "You are always with me. You are found. I see you. All that is mine is yours. I am yours." The father waits at the door for the prodigal's return. The father goes out to bring the older brother back in. And perhaps the key to our faithfulness is recognizing God's presence alone and God's presence to reconcile us with one another. That it is God who unites us. Jesus says to the crowd, or to the disciples following this young man, rich young ruler walking away, Jesus says, "With human beings it's impossible, but with God all things are possible." So at this point, the parable ends. We don't know if the young, older son ever came into the party. We don't know. It doesn't tell us. We don't know if he came, except that his father's response to the younger son's return, if he came to accept that. It is as if Jesus is asking the Pharisees and the scribes if they're going to join him in reaching out to their wayward brothers and sisters, to these tax collectors and sinners. If they are going to rejoice with him over God's most gracious mercy, or if they, like the older brother, will refuse to enter the banquet room, preferring to be on the outside, thinking of nothing but their resentment over the reconciliation between God and sinners that Jesus came to bring home. And perhaps that's just where we should leave it today, is this uncomfortable place where we ourselves have to answer. Will we follow God and welcome home, or will we stay outside? We who embrace the beauty and fullness of being God's own, will we take time to consider that outstretched hand of God to be kind and generous with those whose lives with God have been messier, even a bit rejecting of the things of faith? Is that our real calling? Those who have these God-sized holes in their heart, who say, "I don't believe in God," but who whisper, "But I miss him." How will we know unless we ourselves step out to welcome? Perhaps it will be your outstretched arm who greets that one when they turn searching for home. Perhaps that is our inheritance. We love, says Scripture, because God first loved us. And perhaps our faithfulness includes that concern and compassion for those who are away from the Father's heart, to be ready first at the door to welcome them home. Amen. Let's stand and affirm what we believe. We will be using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He is seated in heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Ever-searching God, whose arms are always open, longing to embrace us in return to the power and gift of your love, we acknowledge that you have called us to joyful living. You have called us to be a light of joy in the world that reminds people of the gift of your love and your mercy. But we also know the ways that we have succumbed to joylessness in our own lives, and the ways that we have lived without joy, sometimes by choice, sometimes by an unwillingness to recognize what we have been blessed with, sometimes by mere indifference, by apathy, by simply pursuing all kinds of ideas of false joy and contentment. Lord, open our eyes to the truth of the joy that rests in you and your presence with us. By your creation, you bring joy into the world and into our lives, and by your presence you confirm the goodness and power of joy as the source of who we are. We pray especially today for all those who experience the absence of joy. We pray for those who find life very difficult and very hard. We pray for those in the Bahamas and other places whose lives have been torn apart by storms, natural disaster. Lord, help us to remember them and to reach out to them with open arms, sharing what we have to help restore their lives. We pray for the sick, those who must constantly wonder about their own health and their own well-being. We pray for the homeless and the lonely, those who seem to wander day after day because of mental illness, because of addictions, countless reasons that seem to lead us astray from you. We pray for the hurting, for those who are simply sad and ill at ease, and for those who can't seem to be satisfied, and for ourselves. We just don't have a sense that things are right. We pray, giving thanks for the joy that you give us in the life and work of your church. We pray that you would continue to help us to engage in the work of mission, the work of justice and peace. We pray that you would continue to send us out to be in conversation and relationship with those who no longer believe in joy, no longer believe in the wonder of your presence in their lives. We pray for churches that find themselves in the midst of conflict. We pray for congregations that are struggling, decreasing in size, and beginning to feel irrelevant and hopeless. Lord, restore to us the confidence and the joy and the energy and the passion that comes from knowing that you are Lord of the church. Indeed, Lord of this particular congregation of which we are a part. Help us to serve you through the life of this people called Park Lake Presbyterian Church. We pray as Jesus taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We continue our worship in the presentation of our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
parents, go in peace, and may the love of God and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the fellowship of Christ's Spirit take you on your way. Amen.